And if you can, be like, grab the microphone and I will do it. I want to thank you for taking time out of your morning and your week at a crazy time to come hear about Wake Up Carolina. This is our third breakfast that we've done. We were planning one last year, but obviously the world stopped and we couldn't have it. But just to give you a quick background, because I know we're running a little over and I want to respect everyone's time to make sure David has enough time to speak. Our background, this is personal to me. I lost my 19-year-old son Creighton to an overdose. It's a very short walk, but I thought it was just us. In this community, it went through zip codes, state lines, and every neighborhood you can think of supported us. Not only did they support our family, but they supported Creighton through this walk and recognized he was so much more than the disease he suffered from. And we made a promise that no family and no person should ever deal with this alone, much less lose someone to find support. Little did I know that that promise would birth an organization that is Wake Up Carolina. Not the name I picked, but the name when many of us sat around and came up with, and a name that I've grown to love. So when we had our first breakfast, it was starting a conversation and bringing awareness. That is when we first started seeing in the news that opioid overdoses and prescribing measures were through the roof. South Carolina led in the country prescribing measures for every man, woman, and child in the entire country. We're not able to do things until we recognize what's really happening. And I was thankful that we were chosen to be on the governor's opioid emergency response team. With that, he had emergency funds immediately allocated to this crisis. The best of the state, the best powers that be to come together and identify where these boundaries and gaps and barriers were. Real gaps, real barriers, real boundaries, where lives are touched and lives are missed. So with that, bringing the awareness, we started going out to the community. What is going on? What is needed? How are we impacted? As a community, as families, as schools, as young adults. Our young adults, many were lost during this period, and still are. It is the third leading cause of death currently, right now. So through starting a conversation, bringing awareness and education, there is time for hope and recovery. I didn't understand what Creighton was fighting for when he went to treatment and said, I want my life and my family and my friends back. And that's all I want. And it's possible. And I told him I wouldn't tell anybody. It's true. Well, he said, you're going to need all the love and support you can get, Mom. And so what I grew to learn through this community with those in recovery is that it is possible. It's real. Young adults can have this. And we need a space. 2 years ago, I sat in this very room with many of you asking for funds for a space so that we were not having to meet with family members in coffee shops, meet with family members in their porches, on the front porch while their child was asleep or at school, or in cars to talk about what we can do, giving resources and support. We wanted a space where young adults that were from the generous donations of the town were providing space for our meetings for our young adults, driving, the furthest we've had a young adult drive is an hour. Driving far to a donated space. And that donated space would get moved because if there was construction or something else going on. So 2 years ago, I looked to you and I said, we need space. We need a safe space for family members who have been touched by substance use disorder to come and talk and feel connection. We need space for our trainings and education, and we need space for these young adults to feel welcomed and included and safe. And you rose to the occasion. From the college's Charleston student that donated $10 a month to one of our largest donors that donated a significant amount to say, I don't ever want you to be worried that Crate's House won't exist. It should always exist. We opened the doors. So now I'm updating you on where we are. We've provided 27 treatment scholarships since we started that program last summer during the middle of the pandemic, during all of our fundraisers closed last year. We have a mother's group that what started out as a conversation turned into 17 to 20 women women that, whether the loved one is still here, whether the loved one is no longer here, their loved one is in recovery, or their loved one is not interested. This is a family disease. Family recovery is necessary. So our mothers group is a bond like no other. That is at capacity. We have 17 to 20 women in this small room. Young adult group, we have anywhere from 15 to 20 kids driving to a meeting to have pizza every night, and all of y'all have like little story cards to let you know quotes from different people in our programs. That one said, pizza's the best part of the meeting, but I keep coming back. So that's pretty big. We had two people in our young adult group celebrate 1 year. They started with us as soon as they got out of treatment, and these are their people. We do a night out for young adults. They're having a Friendsgiving this month. Last month, they did a Halloween party, as well as celebrating one of our participants' 1 year anniversary. It was really special. And Taylor, our young adult program director, presented them with a really cool coin and a cake. The other things we do, we have a dad-to-dad group. We're not trying to take the place of any other meeting out there. Al-Anon, AANA, Nar-Anon, recovery, we need all of them. Recovery, refuge recovery, we need them all. The more that we can build in those gaps to support this tapestry of recovery, that's what we're here for. I know I'm going over and I want David to have time, but where I'm coming to you is our meetings are at capacity. And who would have thought in 2 years, starting a conversation, asking for space, instead of being one employee, we now have one full-time, three part-time, and now we're naming an intern from Trident Tech. So it's exciting times, we're busting the seams, but I am asking you to continue to rise this call. Be part of this community organization that doesn't rely on one donor, does not rely on one random day of this or DHEC. We're thankful to have those, but we want to have as many people be part of this collective community of making recovery sustainable in a part of our conversation with the community. So I'm going to introduce David. Come up. Is it video or David? Which one comes up first? You think I know.
Video.
Sorry. Okay. Here's the video.
Can you believe it? 5 years. Wake Up Carolina is celebrating 5 years of working and serving in our greater community. You know, sometimes I have to pinch myself and say, can you imagine? 5 years ago, I had no idea what was needed, but this community shared what was needed. What I thought was just my experience alone and my family's was anything but. Over the past 5 years, we grew from a conversation into acknowledging that young adults need a place to come and meet and gather, and that we are a space for you to call, come, meet, gather, and we will sit with you. We will sit with you and listen without judgment, but be able to share through lived experience what we've done and where we are. So I'm excited for you to get a peek of the work we have been fortunate enough to do, that you've supported, that our greater community has supported, and without you, we would not be honoring the past 5 years, and we're excited to where this will go. So tonight is an event that we've done for 3 years, and it is a true testament to the partnership, what a community is. A community stands alongside of you, individuals through the really great times and some of the most challenging times. And to be able to be part of something bigger than me, bigger than my family, bigger than our organization, is a community.
I think Wake Up Carolina has a huge impact on our community. We know that opioid overdoses are an all-time high after the pandemic, and then the use of fentanyl being in all the drugs on the street. So some of the measures that we take as far as harm reduction, Narcan distribution and training, fentanyl testing strip kits that are new recently, all of those measures are really helpful for keeping people alive so that they can get help.
My life, I was just lucky enough to get involved with them, and I had a mission to help people that are going through what I went through years ago since I've been in recovery. So I've been able to help lots of people one-on-one. I started a meeting there. I've been able to help groups of people. So I've been able to accomplish my mission since when I got clean.
You know, it's been a walk. We've been walking right alongside of one another for 5 years, acknowledging me, what I know, what I don't know, as well as a town and the leadership within the town and the leadership of law enforcement to recognize what they do and don't know and be willing to build something together that we hope is sustainable and that is lasting and that is authentic and true, that we truly care about each and every person in the greater community and whatever we can do together to build one another to make it better.
For me personally, you know, I'm in recovery myself, and Creighton's House and Wake Up Carolina as a whole was really monumental in my own recovery journey. When I was first trying to get sober, I found Creighton's House through the program director at the time, Nate Lyles, who I knew from College of Charleston. And he connected me to other young people who were walking the same walk that I was. And it just served as a place where I could come as I was, you know, didn't have to be shined up and pretty, and connect with other young people. So like being able to have that safe space where I could come authentically as I was really crucial for opening my mind up to different avenues of recovery.
The strength that we wake up with when we don't know what that day is gonna bring, we don't have it. But to know that there are others that have walked this path that are willing to be there with you is probably one of the most difficult places. But to know here we are all tonight, those in recovery, those honoring the their loved ones, their sons, their wives, their children, their friends, for the hope that it's gonna be better and the strength that we're all together. Maybe we don't know how it's gonna look, but we're all in this together, and that brings a lot of power, for sure. So tonight brings about the power, strength, and hope. That's what strength is. It's the strength and the power of hope.
When you're looking for treatment for yourself or for a family individual, it's a very like crazy thing just to like search on the internet. So what we do is we can help walk the walk with you, help provide that guidance. One of the things that I do for people, say somebody's mom reaches out to me and they want to get into treatment, but they're not sure where to start. What I do is I can call the treatment center, figure out what the day-to-day looks like, figure out what insurance is accepted, what the prices are going to be. So I can handle all that for them so that when it comes down to it, I have a list of phone numbers they can call and figure out which one is the right one for them, rather than them Googling on the internet, not really knowing what to be looking for. So I think that's a big thing that we provide, because I know in my experience when my mom was looking for treatment centers, she relied on the Dr. Phil website. So, you know, we want to have better resources for these people to send their kids, and we're not going to send your kid or you somewhere that we wouldn't go ourselves. I think our network is really a great starting point for what we provide in the community. Aside from that, the harm reduction is amazing. We have people come back and tell us that the Narcan kits that we provided them or trained them in, they've been able to reverse an overdose with that. For families, our mother's group and our dad's group and our siblings group allows for family members to come and talk about the impact that the disease has had on them. And I think that's really important because this is a family disease and everybody's impacted by not just the person that's using. So I think those are all really, really amazing ways that we can touch our community. This is a place where you can show up authentically as you are. And for me, getting to do that was so important. And it allowed me to start building that trust with people that wanted to help me.
To think how much we've grown into, to think how much we've grown from 5 years ago starting a conversation, where would we be in a year? Where will we be in five? My hope is that we double and triple the numbers of individuals and families we're already serving. My hope is that we have a larger space to meet those needs. It starts with you, one person, one conversation, $1, 1 hour of your time. We need you to go to this next level. This is exciting times, and we're excited to share it with you. And I mean, it is really hard to believe, but you know, what a gift that this community has held us up for 5 years, one person at a time, helping one person at a time.
My friends, the recovery community here in Charleston. Everyone needs a little bit of help along the way. You heard Nancy talk about how this disease robs us of our family, our friends, our happiness, and our souls. And I was one of those children that had lost everything as a result of this disease. Our recent pandemic has riddled our youth with mental health issues, with substance abuse and substance misuse. And now more than ever, we need you, we need Wake Up Carolina, we need the support of this community. We need Creighton's House. We need a safe place for our children to go in a time of need. We need a community and a fellowship of people to help other fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters understand that they are not alone, that they are not suffering alone. This disease feeds off of loneliness. It wants us to be lonely and isolated and scared. That's what it wants us to do. And because of places like Creighton's House and people like Nancy and the great recovery programs that are out there in our community, we don't have to be alone. I can tell you that it's a slippery slope. The disease of alcoholism and addiction, it is insidious, and as they say, it's cunning, baffling, and powerful. I was born right here in Charleston. My mom and dad, David and Lillian, moved here from North Carolina shortly before I was born. They were about 24 years old when I was born. And talk about a lucky kid, born into a life of privilege. You know, two college-educated parents who had grown up with every opportunity in the world, who moved here to Charleston not knowing anybody. My dad moved down here and started a car dealership. And I was born right over on Cottingham Drive in Mount Pleasant. And lived in a little townhome there. I don't know if you know those six townhomes that are all in that little strip at the front of Cottingham Drive, right over there in Hoover Estates. But that's where we lived. And I was lucky to have two very wonderful, loving parents with a lot of loving friends and support. But you know, despite how everything appeared on the outside, you know, I was a beautiful, tow-headed, rambunctious young man, looked just like number 22 with that Wando jersey that you saw in that picture, little Creighton. That's what I looked like growing up, tow-headed young boy. But for some reason, as I started to develop, as I was growing up, I always had this emptiness inside me and this hole in my soul. And despite all of these privileges that I had on the outside, you know, I got dropped off at Portugal every morning in a Jaguar, you know, and I came home to a hot meal, and I had two loving parents that tucked me in to bed at night and told me they loved me, and we said our prayers. Despite all of those things, as I went through my childhood, I never really felt like I belonged. I always felt different from and apart from. Even when I was in a big crowd of people with all my friends, I always felt a little bit alone. And so as I progressed into my teen years and had that opportunity to take my first sip of alcohol, from the first time that ever happened, I felt like, for the first time ever, that I was at home, and that I was whole, and that I felt a sense of belonging, and a sense of relief. And from that first sip of alcohol, from that first time I felt that high, all I could ever think about until 17, that first sip of alcohol progressed into that first, took off a joint, and then that first snort of cocaine, and that first misuse of the Ritalin that my parents got prescribed for me so that I could study better and pay better attention in school, and on down the list. And my parents recognized from a very young age that something was off and that I was not walking the path that I needed to walk. And so they, again, very supportive, were there for me all throughout the way. They got me into seeing a counselor by the age of 14 because I had started acting out at school. I was invited to leave Portugal after the seventh grade, where I then went to East Cooper, another small private school that used to be here in Mount Pleasant, where I lasted all of a year and a half until I was invited to leave there because of my drug use and my acting out behavior. So my parents thought, well, maybe if we just get him away from these bad kids he's hanging out with, maybe if we get him away from this crowd that he's started running with, that he can do better. And I went off to boarding school, where I lasted all of 6 months before being invited to leave there. And I came back here, where I enrolled in WANDO, and shortly thereafter, I was invited to leave there. And throughout that process, I went through a number of treatment centers, outpatient treatment centers, therapists who I figured out how to manipulate. My disease and my alcoholism was progressing. My family, my friends, I isolated myself from all of them, and I continued to be plagued with this loneliness and this fear, and I continued to go down the path of disease and addiction. At the age of 17, as I look back today, very luckily, I got myself into trouble with the law. It's not the first time, but I got myself into some trouble that could have had a very lasting effect. And my parents packed me up in the car, and they drove me down to Sarasota, Florida, to a long-term treatment center. And I thought I was going to one of these other country club treatment centers where I had attended, and stuff like Fenwick Hall and others that were here in the community that was sort of like a country club rehab. And so, I willingly, say goodbye to all my friends. Hey, I'll be in touch shortly. Packed my bags and headed south. My parents were divorced at the time, but they got in the car together and they drove me 520 miles down to Florida to take me into this treatment center. And once I got there, I realized that it was anything but a country club treatment center. It was a place where I was going to stay until I was better. And I realized that after the door shut and I got inside and I saw that there were no doorknobs on the inside of the doors. And my parents were there, and I remember that day. I'll never forget it because my parents, they let them come in to give me a hug goodbye. And as they gave me a hug, I latched on to my dad and I wouldn't let go. And I was like, don't leave me here, don't leave me here. And they literally physically had to remove me from my parents' arms. And as they turned to leave, they said, I love you, David. And you know what I said? I hate you. I hate you, and I'll never speak to you again. And that's what they left and turned around and drove back to Charleston with. And that's what this disease does to us. But they loved me enough to allow me to hate them for a period of time, as opposed to losing me. And they drove down there to Florida every other weekend and stayed in a hotel for the better part of the next 6 months while I worked my way through the first phases of that program, as they were required to do by the family program. And it saved my life. And I went through that program. I was in there 16 months. And I got out and I entered into a program of recovery in the community where I've continued to participate in that program of recovery for the last 30 years. And as I mentioned, this disease feeds on loneliness. It feeds on despair. It wants us to isolate ourselves. But recovery is a program of togetherness. It's a program of spirituality. It's a program of knowing that I am no longer alone and that I don't have to walk this journey alone. It's a program of honesty. It's a program of acceptance, love, tolerance, forgiveness, joy, and happiness. Those are things that I had never known before I entered the program of recovery. It's about togetherness, it's about support, it's about helping each other, and it's about service. That void and that emptiness that I had before I was introduced to a program of recovery and to a relationship with a higher power, that void is now filled within me. It's filled with love. It's filled with an understanding and appreciation of that I can't do this alone. I need help. I don't have to be alone. I don't have to be in control. I don't have to be right. It's a wonderful, beautiful freedom that I never knew existed. And I only have that here today because of people like you. Because of the support of my family and my parents who never gave up on me. Because of my friends, like David Wise sitting here today, like Amy Leland, who we grew up with, like Nancy. My friends that never turned their back on me. Now, there was a time when they said, no more. We will no longer tolerate this behavior from you. You cannot live in our home. You cannot come into our homes. You cannot be part of our lives if you are going to live like this. But we will be here to support you. We will love you. We will prop you up. We will get you whatever help you need. But we will no longer feed your addiction. It is because of those support systems that I'm here today. It is because of those support systems that I was able to meet my soulmate, who's here today. My wife, who has been with me and supported me for the last 25 years. It is because of those things that I've been able to have my own children, who I'm now raising. Four little tow-headed blonde children that were just like me, just like Creighton. I have a 15-year-old daughter now who's starting to go through some of the same things that we were going through at this age. And I'm trying to figure out the right answers of how to parent her. And I couldn't do that without the support of people like you. So today, I'm here to ask for your help. All of these things that Nancy talked about, they cost money. All of these programs, this Narcan, this safe space that we need for our children, for our siblings, our families, for people to come and meet and enjoy a safe, sober space. These tools and these resources, the fact of the matter is they cost money. And you think about all these national charities that are awesome, that we support throughout our lives, and all of these causes that we support at a national level. There's not a lot of things that we can do at a local level to truly make a difference in our community. And this is one of them. Because of the sacrifice that Nancy and Cheryl and their family experienced through the loss of Creighton, this fellowship, and this support system was born. So today, I'm here to ask you to reach into your wallets, to go to your donation card, and to help this foundation and to help this support system grow. And let's see what we can do to keep this from happening to other people in our community, to provide a group for our community to be here so that when someone's child is going through what I was going through, their parents can find a place to get help for their child or their sibling. So when people lose a child, they don't have to turn to addiction and depression. They have a place they can go to get help. It's uncomfortable to talk about money. It's uncomfortable to ask people for money. It's just one of those things that's difficult to do. But I'm here today to ask you to do that. And Jessica and I would like to kick off this fundraising campaign by making a pledge. And that pledge is that we are going to donate up to $25,000 for every dollar raised today. We will match that amount up to $25,000. So do not leave money, do not let this organization leave money on the table. We need you to donate today. You can double your dollars by giving. And all of that money is tax deductible. You get a full tax deduction for it. And it will all go to the programs in support of Creighton's House, to the Narcan, to the getting a safe place. We need a house. We need a physical location. We are busting at the seams in our current location. We need some real estate. And we all know Mount Pleasant real estate ain't cheap. So please, support Creighton's House, support Nancy, and help us with that cause today. Thank you very much for your time, and thanks for coming out.
It's hard to fit together faces of who we serve and what we do, but we do have permission for some of the pictures.
tables, but what we decided that it would be better to do a quick slideshow, kind of old school, so you can see over 5 years, community events, advocacy events, and the faces that we serve with many of our programs. And again, don't be a stranger. Our driveway is on Coleman Boulevard. We sit between King and Coleman, 857D. Come take a peek at our space. Again, we are busting, but we want to see you. We're going to start the slideshow. We'll be around for any questions or thoughts or to talk. And then, yes. And then Van Cobble will play thankfully after the slideshow. So thank you for your time, and I appreciate every single face that's here, in person or virtual.
No more bad thinking, time for thinking again. World has changed so fast, what it used to be. There's so much change, more and more.